Hello, everybody. We are going to go through some respiratory disorders that we are going to call restrictive. And restrictive disorders are going to either affect on the internal level the gas exchange of the lungs, so the ability of oxygen and CO2 to be traded for one another, or on the external level, they will affect the lungs being able to expand. So they can either be defined as intrinsic. Intrinsic is something inside of the lungs itself affecting gas exchange, or extrinsic, which is something outside of the lungs, but intimately involved with the lungs, preventing adequate gas exchange. So let's get started. And we'll start with extrinsic restrictions. So again, this involves something external to the lungs that restrict expansion either at the level of the lungs themselves being able to expand, the nerves going to the lungs, primarily the phrenic nerve, which drives contraction of the diaphragm. And the nerves can either be peripheral, like the phrenic nerve, or we can deal with more central nervous disorders, which affect things like the brain or the spinal cord. And if you remember, the area of the brain that controls respiration is in the medullary area, and it's referred to as the pons. So anytime you see the word pontine, it's referring to the pons. So we have the dorsal respiratory group, which is a group of neurons in the pons, which generates action potentials in a shape like this. It's called the ramp signal because it looks like a ramp. And when you start to generate these action potentials, that will drive a nervous impulse, which will eventually hit the phrenic nerve and cause diaphragmatic contraction. And then when we're talking about nerves, we also have to keep in mind that we also have the neuromuscular junction, which involves a neuron. So let me draw an axon of a neuron here, and the surface of a muscle cell. And when we're talking about muscular contraction, we are talking about the neurotransmitter acetylcholine, which has to traverse this synapse. And this synapse, which is just a watery space, is the area that acetylcholine has to traverse. Acetylcholine has to bind to its receptor and then cause a conformational or shape change at the level of the receptor to allow the influx of positive ions and give us contraction at a cellular level by getting depolarization. So this connection here between the nerve and the surface of this this muscle cell, that's referred to as the neuromuscular junction. So we need to have good receptors in the tissues here that acetylcholine binds to. Those are muscarinic type receptors. We need to have good transmission of acetylcholine from these nice healthy nerves, which in the somatic system are almost always myelinated. So they're covered in myelin, which helps preserve this signal. Extrinsic restrictions can lead to, and do lead to, hypoventilation. Remember, ventilation is breathing in and out. Like if somebody's on a ventilator, it's breathing for them. That's different than respiration, which is gas exchange. And when we're talking about hypoventilation, that is when the amount of oxygen in, which we signal with a V for ventilation, bringing oxygen in, is altered so that it is less than the CO2 that is building up in the system, which we signify with a Q, which means flow. So the CO2 is carried by the bloodstream, which has to be exhaled in the same ratio that the oxygen is brought in. We call that the VQ ratio, which should be perfectly matched, a one-to-one ratio. When the ratio is less than one, that indicates a ventilation issue, so something is wrong with the lungs. So going through each of these things, the lungs themselves, the nerves, the central nervous system, and the neuromuscular junction, those can fall into a variety of categories, right? So when we think about extrinsic restriction, we can start with external things that are large and prevent lung expansion. So that can fall into compromised thoracic frame or increased resistance to due to some sort of generally abdominal mass. Here we have obesity, which would involve adiposity on the abdominal region. This can also involve pregnancy, where rather than adiposity in the abdominal region, there is a fetus. And this primarily is going to restrict expansion due to increased resistance of what the diaphragm is supposed to do. The diaphragm is here, the abdominal cavity is below that. If there's adiposity or a fetus, there's a little fetus, butting up against the diaphragm and then the lungs, that's going to restrict expansion. This is most prominent when that person is lying down. So things like propping up on pillows is something that reduces that restriction of inhalation to some degree. It doesn't fix the problem, but that can be something that compromises or restricts expansion. We also have things at the level of the thoracic frame. So the thorax is everything above the diaphragm, right? So if I were to draw, as I will right now, some lungs down here. So trachea, lungs, and then the diaphragm associated with it. The diaphragm separates the thoracic from the abdominal cavity. And in the thoracic cavity, we have the sternum, which protects the heart. And associated with that are the 12 ribs. And as long as they are all in place and we have a good space, if we look now at a coronal section, between the back ribs attached to the vertebral bodies and then the front where we have the sternum associated with the ribs, we need to have a specific amount of space between the sternum and the vertebra in order for the lungs and also the heart to be able to expand to their fullest capabilities. So this can be compromised either through mechanical trauma that can occur at the level of the thorax, so broken ribs, broken sternum, anything that is inserted or removed from the thoracic cavity, those can all restrict expansion. We can also have a compromised thoracic frame due to congenital malformations, of which there are many. I'll give you one example today, and it is called pectus excavatum. And to excavate means to dig into, right? If you excavate something on an archaeological dig. So excavatum, pectus excavatum, so around the pectoral region, is when, rather than having this whatever normalized spaces between the sternum and the vertebra, there's a notched sternum. So we end up with a small amount of space between the sternum and the vertebral bodies. What that means is that the lungs and then the heart itself won't be able to expand to their fullest capabilities. And this can be fixed in one of two ways, either through mechanically removing the sternum and then resetting the ribs, and the patient being chronically implanted with the apparati that are implanted, or by threading a metal bar underneath each of the arms. So there's two incisions made, one under each armpit, and then the bar is flipped, and that cracks the ribs away from that intercostal cartilage, which allows the sternum and ribs to set in the place that the surgeon wants them, and the cartilage will reset and the bar is kept in place for about 3 years. And this is a surgery that's done when there is a small clinically relevant space in between the sternum and the vertebra, which restricts expansion. So yes, just keep in mind, anything external to the lungs that will physically be characterized as an extrinsic restriction. So compromised frame, increased resistance due to adiposity or a fetus pregnancy. We can also have this occur due to muscular weakness. And the main family, although there are very many things that can cause muscular weakness, one of the family of disorders are called the muscular dystrophies. And dys means bad or deranged, where trophy is referring to growth. So a dystrophy is an abnormal growth or development of the muscles. And there are a variety of types of muscular dystrophy. And when we see them presenting in children, we can generally assume that they're inherited conditions. And there's a variety of them. We have fascioscapulohumeral dystrophies. There are limb girdle dystrophies. And then there are two genetic dystrophies that you may be familiar with, which can definitely affect respiration. The first one is called Duchenne's muscular dystrophy, and this is a disorder that is almost always present in boys, and generally females are carriers to it. Of course, there's always exceptions to that, but generally you see presentation in males and not females, whereas the females can be carriers. In Duchenne's muscular dystrophy, there is a genetic alteration and almost, or generally, a complete lack of a protein called dystrophin. And because there is a complete lack of dystrophin, there is a very rapid progression of loss of muscle movements. So it appears very early on. You can see abnormalities in walking or late walking, and then a progressive loss of muscle strength, eventually affecting the muscles of respiration, like the diaphragm. So this is an absence of dystrophin, where the next type, whoops, there's a C there, called Becker's muscular dystrophy. It is not a complete lack of dystrophin, but a almost near lack or low level of dystrophin. And it is enough of a lack of dystrophin to interrupt normal muscle function. It is another genetically inherited dystrophy, and it presents during childhood. Whereas when you see muscular dystrophies appear in adulthood, the most commonly appearing one in adulthood is called myotonic dystrophies. Myo is muscle, and tonic or tone is referring to the tone or sustained contraction of muscles. And in myotonic types of dystrophies, one of the most prominent features is a slow in relaxation after contraction. So you might see somebody, they reach for a doorknob, and when they contract their hand to turn the doorknob, it takes longer for the hand to relax. This happens after a handshake as well. And you'll see it start with these more distal muscles like fingers and hands, and then it progresses to the more central muscles like those of respiration. So those muscular dystrophies, because of an abnormality in the system, either through a genetic abnormality or a lack of integrity of the nerves that function to the muscles of ventilation, we see muscular weakness and then an inability to fully expand the lungs. All right, so those were some muscular dystrophies. Then we'll move on to the final family of things that can cause extrinsic restrictions, which is compromised neuromuscular junction function. Junction function. So here's our neuromuscular junction. It involves the nervous terminal, so the nerve terminal releasing acetylcholine, and that acetylcholine binding to its receptors, its muscarinic type receptors, and then the influx of positive ions, allowing depolarization and then eventually contraction. So we need to have these nerves be able to signal. So the nerves need to be intact, and we also need to have adequate binding of acetylcholine to its receptor sites for action. All right, so moving through this, central nervous system depression. So the central nervous system can become depressed, not in a sad way, but in a decreased function way, by substances that increase a neurotransmitter called GABA, gamma-aminobutyric acid. And just as I drew up there, a receptor that had acetylcholine binding to it and positive ions flooding in, when GABA binds to its receptor and causes a conformational or shape change, it opens up a pore and allows the influx of negative ions like chloride. And when you have a negative ion enter a cell, it drives down the charge of that cell. It hyperpolarizes it, making it less likely that that cell engages in its action, which for muscle is to contract. So things that increase GABA activity increase chloride transmission into cells, hyperpolarize those cells, make them less excitable. It's not impossible to have contraction or, excitement of a cell to the level of its action potential or the charge it needs to get to carry out its action, but it is more difficult because the charge is driven lower. So this GABA, this gamma-aminobutyric acid, is the main inhibitory neurotransmitter in the system. And there are drugs that increase GABA, and they're, relatively well-known drugs. One of the most common GABA-increasing substances is good old alcohol, ETOH, ethyl alcohol. Alcohol is, in essence, a GABA drug. It increases GABA, and then selectively, in a dose-dependent manner, meaning the higher the dose, the more it does that, it inhibits neurons. So it inhibits first, muscular function, coordination, your inhibition in your prefrontal cortex, so you know when to talk and when not to talk, when to dance on the table, when not to. And eventually it progresses to inhibition of deep areas of the brain and eventually causes inhibition of those centers which control respiration. So the overdose state of alcohol is respiratory depression. You also see that with opiates at a certain level, and it's not so much due to GABA, though it does definitely have GABA effects. Opiates are derivatives of substances taken from the opium poppy, derived from the opium poppy, whereas opioids, oid means kind of like, opioids are synthetic derivatives of the opium poppy. So things like heroin, hydrocodone, fentanyl, any of those substances, their overdose state is also respiratory depression. That involves the binding of opiates to their receptors. There's mu, delta, and kappa, but in the areas of the brain and brain stem that control respiration, there's a lot of mu receptors. So when there's a high level of that drug taken, then it inhibits respiration. Back to GABA drugs, though, we've got alcohol. We also have benzos, benzodiazepines, so Valium, anything that ends in Pam or Lam, Alprazolam, Diazepam. In high enough levels, those, in the same way that alcohol does, in a dose-dependent way, they cause the increase of GABA and also the decrease alcohol does this too. It decreases the main excitatory neurotransmitter, which is called glutamate. So it increases the inhibitory neurotransmitter, decreases the excitatory transmitter, and the overdose state of benzodiazepines is respiratory depression. And one of your final ones are barbiturates. Let me draw the whole name out for you because this is like the hill that I go to die on. I have one and it's this. Barbiturates. A lot of people say barbiturates. And when they do, that makes my soul sad on the inside. Barbiturates. Look it. There's an R there. Barbiturates. Barbiturates, so those are things that end in barbitol, like phenobarbital. Those were the drugs that were given for things like anxiety or hysteria in women, which is caused by having a uterus. Fun fact. Barbiturates are a substance. It's a mix of uric acid and a novel substance, which was created on the day of the Feast of Saint Barbara. So they called it barbituric acid. And as a drug class, they're called barbiturates. So please respect that R. If you say barbiturates and I hear it, I will cry, at least on the inside. So those drugs are, they work in a similar way to benzos. However, they're very, very potent. They also have something called a low therapeutic index, which means that the dose you need for them to work is really close to the dose that you need to overdose on them. And again, the overdose state of these types of drugs is respiratory depression. So CNS depression, definitely a way to get extrinsic restriction. If you inhibit respiratory centers, you definitely are going to restrict ventilation, right? Yes. All right, now nerve disease. There are so many different types of nerve diseases, unfortunately, for everybody. Let's see, what are some nerve diseases? We've got, it's French, and I do not speak French, although I wish I did, Guillain-Barré syndrome, which is an interesting inflammatory disorder, and it is an autoimmune issue whereby the body makes antibodies against nerve cells, specifically a lot of activity at the level of the myelin, which encases the nerves and allows conduction of electricity. And neurons and nerves communicate with one another through electric signals. So whenever something is covered in antibody, that means it's tagged for destruction. So there's a macrophage being called to that nerve, which it will then destroy. Guillain-Barré is a disorder that definitely is going to affect the muscles of respiration, and there is a profound effect on the muscles involved in coughing. It seems to be that Guillain-Barré, like other autoimmune diseases, we don't spontaneously start to make these antibodies, or what we call autoantibodies. Auto means self. So autoantibodies are antibodies that bind to and tag normal, healthy self cells of the body. So we don't spontaneously do that. Generally, something causes that. And we don't always know what the precipitating event is, but in Guillain-Barré syndrome, you can see this pop up after an infection with a variety of either viruses or bacteria. So Campylobacter, which is a bacteria present in uncooked poultry, can be the precipitating event for the development of these autoantibodies. Zika virus can cause this disorder to pop up. The hepatitis viruses and COVID-19, these can all cause the prevalence and the popping up of autoantibodies. And then the development of Guillain-Barré, which can progress so far as to require mechanical ventilation. Some other nerve diseases. Let's see, what else do we have? Oh, Parkinson's. Parkinson's is a disorder where we mainly think of low levels of dopamine, and that's how we target treatment for this disorder by supplementing dopamine in the form of levodopa or L-DOPA. And the reason we give L-DOPA and not dopamine is because dopamine is too big to make it through the blood-brain barrier. So L-DOPA is converted into dopamine by a specific enzyme, which I'm just going to get crazy now. So never mind. Let's not talk about that. It is converted into dopamine by a series of enzymatic alterations. But one of the main issues in Parkinson's disease is dopamine is inhibitory on acetylcholine. And acetylcholine, as you know, is really highly associated with muscle contraction. So you see a lot of alterations to muscle contraction, which manifest as different tremors or tonic type of contractions. And also cholinergic abnormalities, so issues with swallowing and also with respiration. Whenever somebody has difficulty swallowing or chewing, it's usually not a good thing. It's one of these early predictors, actually, of Parkinson's, because you see a lot of alterations to the muscles of chewing, of swallowing, and eventually of respiration. All right, then finally, we have the neuromuscular junction disorders. So this is specifically right here. This isn't involving the nerves, like we talked about with the Guillain-Barré, things of that nature. We're talking directly at the level of this neuromuscular junction, of acetylcholine binding to its receptors. So these neuromuscular junctions, there's one in particular that you should know about, myasthenia gravis. Myasthenia gravis is one of these other autoimmune disorders which affects healthy self cells of the body, but in this case, the body makes antibody against acetylcholine receptors. And we don't like that, right? So we know anything covered in antibody is tagged for destruction. So here this macrophage is going to come kill and destroy this acetylcholine receptor. So if there's no acetylcholine receptor for acetylcholine to bind to, we're not going to have good contraction, right? So this disorder is mainly expressed in women, especially in middle age. Why is that? We don't really know, but that is what we see. So myasthenia gravis, and this causes progressive muscle weakness. And one of the first signs of this is called ptosis. It's a silent P, and that is when there is weakness of the eyes. Specifically, we see bilateral ptosis. So not just one eye gets tired, but both of them. And if you notice at the end of the day, your eyelids feel heavy, well, they're supposed to do that. Your eyelids are up here, and you're holding them open all day, right? And eventually you get tired of that. So the eyelids start to put pressure on the eyes and you can't hold them open anymore. And now you need to go to bed. So in myasthenia gravis, you see this bilateral ptosis, which is telling you that one of the main functions we do, keeping our eyelids open, becomes more difficult to do. So myasthenia gravis is a problem with acetylcholine binding because we get the selective destruction of these acetylcholine receptors. Remember, we also have acetylcholine receptors on the diaphragm, on all smooth muscles. So you can see neuromuscular junction disorders affect respiration also. All right, Intrinsic restrictions are inside of the lungs. And when we are talking about these types of fibrotic disorders, remember, osis means development of, and fibro is referring to scar tissue. Pulmonary fibrosis and other intrinsic disorders are not affecting the lungs themselves. They are affecting the respiratory membrane. And the respiratory membrane, remember, is involving what we have here, the alveolar type 1 cell, which is the alveolus epithelial membrane itself, and then the capillary membrane. And between those two things is a very thin and small basement membrane where we have new cell division coming up, stem cells which convert into mature cells to replace the cells as they die. All right, so gas exchange over this very thin membrane. So this is one cell, one alveolar cell, and then one capillary cell. Capillaries are one cell thick. This is such a thin membrane that gases exchange very easily over this membrane. When there is inhalation of any type of substance that we consider an occupational exposure, a deleterious substance, when we're inhaling things that are not air, that can include asbestos, which can lead to so much dysplasia. First metaplasia, then dysplasia, and then neoplasia in the form of mesothelioma. Silica, which is an interesting type of substance. It's like a sand used in sandblasting. That's actually how they make jeans look distressed. They shoot silica dust at it. And when you inhale that and it lodges in the interstitium, we call that silicosis. And if you get the black lung, so like coal dust inhalation and black lung disease, that is a type of deleterious inhalation also. And this can also occur due to things like exhaust, smoke. So constant inhalation of things that physically change the thickness of the respiratory membrane. So here inside of the alveoli, we have our respiratory membrane that I tried to draw for you, but this is much cleaner. We've got oxygen crossing over in exchange for CO2. And again, this is one cell thickness on each side with the associated basement membrane. So it's a very easy short distance for gases to flow. And it shouldn't be interrupted. It's a very low resistance, high compliance pathway. When the alveoli are constantly damaged by the inhalation of these deleterious substances, other than air, they start to thicken this membrane. And it is fibrotic. When these membranes start to thicken, it means that we had some sort of damage to the tissue. Remember, organs are high in tissue factor. When tissue factor is expressed, we start the coagulation cascade and get the formation of fibrin. So we get these really thick interstitial walls, which are going to limit gas exchange. So it's really difficult, even if ventilation seems to be well maintained, it is difficult to get gas exchange. So this is very progressive, it's very obstructive, and it is intrinsic because it's the interstitium, the innermost tissue of the lungs at the level of the alveoli. So you see cough, shortness of breath, frequent infection, because you get mucus accumulation and then it's hard to bring up. So really severe intrapulmonary fibrosis actually needs to be treated with lung transplants, because as you know, scar tissue doesn't go away. You can't just remove it. So if this progresses and airflow gets so bad that there's dyspnea at rest, you'll progress to oxygen supplementation around the clock. And then for really severe cases, you will see lung transplant. So just remember, extrinsic is right of the lungs, where intrinsic is airflow affected at the level of the interstitial tissue. Okay, those are your restrictive diseases. Stay smart. Bring outside to anything.